get started then. I don't know if more folks are gonna show up or not, but we can, I know most everybody, but let's go around the room and introduce ourselves. Denise Wheeler, Selectboard.
Cliff Emmons, Calais Selectboard.
Rose Pelchuk, Selectboard.
Katie Lane Curtis, I'm the Recording Secretary.
Stuart Morton.
Alfred Larrabee, Road Commissioner.
Heidi Thompson.
Chris Holcomb.
Stuart Talbot.
Sharon Wynn, Selectboard. Judy Robert, Town Clerk.
Okay. So this is, I just want to let folks know, this is just the first of what will probably be a couple of meetings to talk about this. So if folks weren't able to make it tonight, we're going to try to hold another event, maybe in East Calais, maybe one in Adamant, something like that, because we have, to make sure that we have space for such things as this. There's definitely been a lot of chatter on Front Porch Forum, and I wanted to offer up that some of the issues and questions and things that have come up are answered in a document that we've put out like last year, year before last, frequently asked questions, if folks want a copy of it, which really does answer some of the questions, but...
Does anybody want to copy that?
Yes.
I think tonight...
Here's the operations, winter operations plan.
Right. Tonight we can just go around the room and see what folks want to express as their concern or compliments.
I can start.
Okay, Heidi.
I first want to say that I know everybody is working really hard, the road crew. I know you guys work your butts off. I can't imagine having your job. I appreciate how when we pass each other, we wave to each other. I know that you all must be exhausted, and I know you're fielding a lot of calls from the community. Toby, you are. I mean, there has been a lot of chatter and a lot of concern, and so I'm not coming here from a place of pointing fingers or blame whatsoever. And
thank
the
you
people
for that.
That I talk to in Maple Corner, I mostly talk to Maple Corner folks at the store and people I carpool with. I'm not hearing a lot of blame or finger pointing at all.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just hearing concern and confusion. And I feel like I've been learning a lot just about, I didn't know that the road crew wasn't out in the middle of the night. I didn't know that. Talking to Sharon, I didn't know that Route 14 was
the state.
That was really interesting. So I've been learning a lot.
Right, and that's a good thing.
And that's absolutely a good thing. We've lived here since 1993, and mostly go up and down the county road, although when the kids were at Calais Elementary School, used to be on the roads more. And I've always had good tires, always tried to drive very carefully, especially in the winter time, and always noticed the East Montpelier line, the roads, from 1993 moving here, they're always quite better, not 100%.
You're talking county road, right?
On the county road, yeah. And so for years, I just kind of, Lewis and I kept that to ourselves, and I don't think there was a lot of chatter about it. And Carolyn Morton last year wrote something on the forum about the roads, and I feel like it's opened up conversation that I think is actually healthy for people to start talking about it. And so I think from what I'm hearing, community perspective is that there is a long-term problem here. For some reason, the Calais roads not being as clear in the winter time. I'm talking mostly about the winter.
You're talking county roads today.
I'm mostly talking about county road. What I notice,
okay,
is the difference on the right at the line there. And so I feel like it's time to figure out how to have our roads, and I know you guys have been looking into this to some degree, but I hope there can be further exploration as to how, or like, I'm thinking we need more manpower. I've heard that we have more roads in Calais than we do in East Montpelier. I don't know how it compares to Worcester, but I feel like if we do have more roads to cover, mm-hmm. then it seems like we need more manpower, and that may mean raising taxes. But I feel like it's a public safety issue. In particular now with more ice, with climate change, and the more, you know, thawing and the freezing, that to me, it's just a number one priority to keep everybody safe. And personally, I have, you know, an 18-year-old boy who's driving on the roads now with his 18-year-old boyfriends, and they're inexperienced. They're not crazy kids. They're good kids, but they're really inexperienced, and I am nervous every day for them on the road. Mm-hmm. I'm nuts nervous about myself. I have a good car with studs, and I drive very carefully, and so does my husband. But I'm nervous about people also who can't afford good tires, can't afford to have a all-wheel drive. Mm-hmm. And And then, you know, the more recent concern is hearing that we are low on sand. And to me, I feel like we gotta get more sand so we don't have to skimp, because ice is really scary. And, you know, I slipped on the ice walking outside of my office the other day, you know, because there wasn't sand on it and I wasn't walking fast. You know, and I fell hard, and I thank God didn't get a concussion. But so, anyways, I feel like it's a time to kind of step back. Think short term, let's get more sand, and then long term, let's figure out the roads and maybe getting more manpower out there.
Yeah,
because I get that you guys are at your maxed out.
Yeah, they are.
So. And to me, it's like when I heard that people aren't, you guys aren't plowing in the middle of the night, I understand you need sleep. Makes sense that sometimes the county road isn't plowed while we're going off to work, because you haven't had the hours to plow it and to sand it.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Thank you for your nice comments and willing to understand, you know, that things have changed with the weather. And that's something that we're very well aware of. And this question and answer, she answers your question somewhat with regard to the county road. And as I've learned from Alfred, I've learned a ton about roads, more than I ever thought I would ever know from Alfred over the years. Mm-hmm. And, Calais is situated such that we get the weather from the Worcester Range that East Montpelier doesn't get. Calais is at a higher elevation than East Montpelier. We started using, what's that stuff called? Magic salt, which is what East Montpelier started using. And Alfred, last year, investigated what we might use that would be better, because regular salt doesn't work when the temperature is below 20 degrees. It just doesn't work. And then when it does work, then it creates slush. And then when it freezes, then it creates, you know, so it's a constant battle, but that is a part of an answer to your question, mm-hmm. which I found, that's true, because I know where I live, we're at a higher elevation, we get more snow than some other areas in Calais most of the time. So elevation does play a huge role in this, but thank you very much for your comments. And Katie's taking notes of all this so we can reflect on it and see how we might go forward later. Mr. Morton?
Yeah, I'm not thoroughly prepared, so I have to ask, does anyone know what the town pays for sand? What it costs?
Alfred knows.
It's like $13 a ton.
What is the total cost for the winter for the sand?
It's usually around $60,000.
$60,000.
Right now?
Well, let's imagine that the county road, the West County Road and the asphalt part of the county road is a certain fraction of the, what is it, 93 miles in Calais, I think there is?
Plowable routes? I think it's 70, isn't it like 70?
83.
83?
Okay. Yeah. According to the
well, let's say it's 5% of the total. The total sand that would be that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just throwing this out, but if the amount of sand put down was doubled on the West County Road and the asphalt part of the county road to the East Montpelier line, I can't imagine that would cost a tremendous amount in terms of the percentage of the cost, the overall cost of the sand, or an additional cost. I mean, if it's $60,000, it might be, even if it was much as $5,000, which it probably wouldn't be, it's more like $3,000 in addition if the sand was doubled up for the county road. But let's say it's $5,000 in addition to the $60,000 already paid. And if you take that extra $5,000 and divide it up among the taxpayers, it couldn't amount to very much more per taxpayer per year. I mean, it would be something that I would think most people would willingly pay. Maybe people in East Calais would have their own concerns and then want another $5,000 or $3,000 spent over there too. That could happen, but
yeah.
But the East Calais people aren't here complaining about the safety issue. So it's kind of narrowing down to this neck of the woods.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I have no gripes with the snow plowing that's done at all and the work that they do, but when just like Heidi said, when they get on the county road and you're driving into Montpelier, it can be pretty hairy, and you're only reminded of it when you cross the line into East Montpelier. Now, that line is a demarcation right there. I mean, within a few hundred feet on that hill, that before you go downhill into East Montpelier, there's no great difference in elevation on either side of that town line, but you really notice the difference.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, you also notice the difference on Collar Hill Road when you go to Worcester. I mean, you know right where the town line is by the amount of sand that's on the road. Now, that isn't to say that there isn't an adequate amount of sand putting down necessarily. I mean, it could just as likely be that Worcester's awash in sand and they don't know what to do with it, so they put it down. But it's noticeable there too, for whatever that means.
Uh-huh. Let me ask Alfred a question. Do you put sand on the county road? I thought you didn't put sand on the county road.
We don't put sand because it's got fairly large stones in it, and the stones would bounce up and take windshields out. So we never put sand on the county road.
What is
on the blacktop part?
What is it that goes down?
Salt.
That's just salt?
Just salt.
Okay.
Now, does East Montpelier put sand on their portion of the county road?
No.
They just use that. They just only use salt or that ice be gone stuff, magic salt.
Right.
Now, are you using the magic salt this year?
Yes.
It's just a matter of safety. That's my only concern. And I drive slow too. And I'm more frankly concerned about people coming the other way, the other drivers, than I am about my own driving.
So can I answer or try to answer some of the question about the county road? I usually hit the county road around 4 o'clock in the morning. My first round with salt, 4 o'clock in the morning. So, and then I have to go back to my dirt roads because my route consists of both blacktop and and dirt roads. So I'm at the county road, that's the first thing I do is put the salt on. So some days when it's still snowing, you guys come through at 7, 8 o'clock. The snow is already overtaking the salt. It's our, my salt is not working anymore because it's still snowing and it's still slushy. Mm-hmm. East Mount Pilliar, he's had chance to come back to that a second time because his route is only salt. That's all that truck does is salt. So he's not going back to the shop to switch out and get sand.
So you're also plowing.
I plow and I
salt the county road.
Salt the county road. And I also have dirt roads that I have mm-hmm. to put sand on. So my truck is switching between salt and sand all the time.
Yeah.
So I generally get the county road done first off, and then I go do the sand, the dirt roads with the sand. And then if it still needs it, I go back. So sometimes it's 8, 9 o'clock before I get my dirt roads done mm-hmm. to put the second dose of salt on the county road. Meanwhile, you folks have already gone through because you're going to work, you're going here, there. Mm-hmm. You're seeing it at its worst condition.
Right.
If you come back through at 10 o'clock, you're going to see it's going to be bare again.
Those are such crucial times because that's when the buses come through and that's when most people are going to work.
Right.
Right.
Is there a way to switch the timing around so that you do, and I'm just asking because I don't know.
Well, we could switch routes around. I mean, Lightning Ridge is one of my routes also.
Right,
so Lightning Ridge Road has to be done by 6, 7 o'clock.
Right.
Because there's people going to the school, there's buses
right.
rolling.
That's a main artery.
So I try to get the county road done. Then my very next load is a load of sand that goes to Lightning Ridge.
Are you having to go back to the garage when you switch between salt and
absolutely.
Sand?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay,
yeah.
So you're switching everything. It's,
yeah.
not, it's not like push a button and...
No,
it's probably 20 minutes to switch because I got to clean out all the salt. So I don't want to waste it and mix it with the sand. Mm-hmm. So I dump all the salt back in the salt shed, what I didn't use. Then I have to reload the sand.
Yeah.
So that's, it's not a lot of time, but that's 20 minutes that,
mm-hmm.
and then it's travel time also. Don't
right.
forget, it's from Lightning Ridge back to our shop, which
the garage.
Is 4 miles.
Yeah.
That sounds like an impossible job.
And we have very
well,
little.
Well, it's not impossible.
We have very
I'm doing
little,
it, but it just takes
well,
a little bit more time, and it's
impossible.
And the timing
right,
is not
with
always.
All that to get to the county road at the crucial time.
Well,
people, you know.
And we have very little pavement, so there's not a lot of places that you're using the salt. It's not like
right.
you do county road first, then you do all the other pavement towns. Like you do county
yeah.
road pavement, salt,
and Lightning Ridge pavement. Down by the
right.
store.
Right,
and
then you're switching the sand.
Yeah. That, well, that's why I wonder if there's a, could you do the Lightning Ridge plowing and sanding first and then do the county road salt? I just wonder if that would, if you've already tried that,
right,
maybe.
On some occasions that would work, but the salt takes a little bit of time to activate.
Mm.
It's not automatic. It takes a little bit, so
mm-hmm.
that's why I get the salt on first, so it starts working and it starts. But like I'm saying, when it's snowing, the salt just gets overtaken by the snow.
Right.
And then at 7 o'clock, because I've already cleaned it, it's already plowed and cleaned at 4.
Mm-hmm.
3 hours later, it's covered up with snow again.
Right. And it can snow a lot in 3 hours.
And
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's six. It's a 6 hour. Rodeo. So every time we go out, it's 6 hours. So
right.
if I'm on the county road at 4, it's going to be 6 hours later before I can get back to that, unless I leave some of my smaller roads. Sometimes I leave, like Gray Road, Tucker Road, George Road, I'll leave those because they're not bus routes.
Right.
And
right.
I'll
yeah, we,
get back
we get,
to the
yeah,
county
we get
road
that.
Because that is indeed a more traveled road.
Right. And I know that in that handout, it talks about the rodeo thing, which I learned last year what that really meant. And we do have in our winter maintenance plan that some of the smaller roads may have to wait. Like I know the road I live on, it's not a bus route, it's not a main artery, and that's fine. I'm good with that.
Right.
Is
this, why isn't the asphalt sanded?
Because of the stones that are in the sand, that would kick up and that would be breaking windshields.
The stones would be that
big. Stones that are in the sand.
Right.
Are, yeah, they're half inch in diameter. Half to three quarters inch in diameter.
Right.
So,
I see them on the
curve. You know, if they get, right. So if they get, they kick out of a car tire that's in front of you, that's coming into your windshield.
And then the town
would be looking at liability for that. Mm-hmm. So we just don't put sand. The state stopped using sand on the blacktops for that same reason.
Yeah.
They just don't use it.
And the finer sand, you know, sandbox sand would be just too expensive.
It would be very expensive. Also, it would be very hard to keep it a separate pile. Yeah. I mean, it's hard. It's very hard to keep, you know, multiple piles of different product.
Without them getting mixed up.
Right. Right.
Okay.
It's not easy, folks. It really isn't. It's
so
just a lot.
What can be done?
Let's let everybody have a chance to have their say. Mr. Holcomb?
So my concern is the overnight, because not all of us work a 9-to-5 shift. I work second shift.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm coming home in the middle of the night. And there have been multiple times when I cannot or barely make it up, like Canning Ridge Road, because it's so icy.
Mm-hmm.
I have an all-wheel drive with winter tire. So that's my main concern. If I can't make it home, an emergency vehicle can't make it either during the night.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand that they can't keep the roads, or they can't be out on the roads 24/7.
Right.
But there are people that are out there during the night.
Mm-hmm. Well, right. So, as you said, not everybody works 9-to-5. Other people work different shifts. So I understand that.
And your route was not county, if I'm remembering?
It's Adamant Road,
mostly,
right?
Adamant Road and Lightning Ridge Road.
So
those
you're coming
roads.
Up 14. Up
14 to Lightning Ridge. I mean, I have a 100-mile commute to work, and the only part I dread is Lightning Ridge Road.
Yeah.
Because I work in Burlington.
Mm-hmm.
Granted, it's the only road that's dirt, but...
Okay. Toby, did you want to say anything?
Chris, just so you know, I'm the deputy chief of the fire department, and you know, we deal with roads. Actually, we have chains on our trucks, and if we need an emergency access to a fire, we can reach the town garage and have them. So emergency vehicles really are not so much an issue on the overnights, much as you're coming. Actually, our concern is more somebody's driveway. We have more trouble with people's driveway than we do with the roads, just so you understand that. So it's not as much of an issue for us to not have overnight plowing. And that happens. We deal with some issues in East Montpelier. They don't have a policy of plowing at night either. So the roads in East Montpelier are not plowed in the middle of the night.
They have a policy of not.
Right.
That's correct. Their policy is exactly the same as ours. Middlesex
policy is much the same as ours, because I've been doing some research because of this.
So just so you understand that part of it, is that we're not different than some other towns. And
same as Worcester?
Worcester, Plainfield, Marshfield, Cabot, Woodbury. I looked on their websites and could find no winter operations maintenance plan. Maybe they don't have one. Not every town has one.
And most of them that do are similar.
Excuse me?
Most of them that do, because I look too,
yeah,
have a similar one to ours.
Right, that's correct. Mm.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
Much as that's probably not what you wanted to find.
Right. to me, it's kind of mind-boggling that we don't go out at night. So, I mean, people still need to get to where they're going safely.
But you understand that we have how many, you know, 83 miles of roads to plow.
Mm-hmm.
We have four people. Right now, we're down a truck. We have been using some part-time people to help out with some of the plowing because, for instance, today, one of the regular road crew guys was out sick. You know, that happens. And they do need to get a certain amount of sleep. They can't plow 24/7.
Well, I understand that.
So it's a dilemma, and you know, we need to figure it out. We're open to suggestions, ideas, conversation, to see what we can do. Judy, did you want to weigh in?
I'm curious about the idea of having other sites for the sand or the salt.
I was gonna wonder about
that. To shorten the time that they have that of the loading and the unloading, and if there's town land, and I know you also would need a bucket loader to load it, so that you know it ends up getting costly. But
right.
If it ends up changing so that it's 5 minutes or 10 minutes to reload, rather than all the way over to the opposite end of the town to reload.
Well, you remember in spring,
would absolutely cut down on the time.
In the springtime, for the last couple of years, you had a really good idea, which was to put sand or gravel at the town hall in the parking lot there, because we weren't using the town hall because it was being renovated. That's no longer an option. Is there any other place on this side? I mean, there's not enough room here at the town office parking lot to put a big pile of sand or gravel.
School?
Well, the big problem is you need another piece of equipment to load the sand.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't just have it in one place, because if somebody, we have a route that does the whole side of East Calais and that side of town, and it's very convenient for him there. So if we move the loader to this side of town for the other routes, he couldn't reload his truck.
So we'd have to get another loader.
We'd have to buy another $80,000 loader in order to make that.
Do they ever collaborate with other towns, being that Worcester's just down Collard Hill, or just down the Worcester Road? Like, because they would have that, and they would have sand, and it's close to county, but I don't know what the applications are with a collaboration with another town.
Well, yeah, if we put our piles of stuff there and then maybe paid a lease fee or something like that.
I'm sure Worcester is cramped for space also. I mean, these piles of sand take a lot of space.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, that's something to look into. I'd be happy to look into that.
Yeah.
I know the road commissioner in Worcester really well, and I'm sure that he would be open to it if it's feasible for him. But then you got to keep track of yardage, and you've got a lot of keeping track to do.
Right.
And then timing. Some days he's going to be out sanding where we're not, and we want a load of sand, and he's not there. And, you know, I know Plainfield and Marshfield does that.
They do.
Marshfield has sand at Plainfield's pit their yard, because their roads are closer. Maple Hill is closer to Plainfield garage, so they do that. I don't know how it works out. I could look into that.
Right, they might have some simple way of calculating, having an administrative, just a sheet where they write it down.
Right.
Well, I know you're busy dodging the storms, but I think that's an option that's worth having you check out.
Right.
I bet there'd be people who would donate land to do that, except that you have to have the other piece of equipment, which doesn't make a lot of sense.
You also, Alfred, when you were talking about your schedule, it seems like you have a very predictable schedule, and maybe there's possibilities of changing that, but even the way it is, it's predictable. If you're out at 4 putting salt down, and then there's a sweet spot in terms of timing, right? So this is, to me, where maybe communication and letting people know this is the schedule, this is how it works. A really good time to be on County Road after is, you know, an hour and a half after Alfred's been through with the salt truck, which is in this window.
But again, that's going to work for some and not for others.
For some people, it might be like, half an hour earlier makes a big difference, or waiting a couple of hours makes a big difference, and they can, you know, maybe they have that flexibility.
So a lot of the bus routes were calculated to get the bus routes open and safely sanded. So a lot of the planning of how the bus routes go, and they actually change every year because bus routes change.
Sure.
And we sit down and Alfie recalculates, well, you need to go this part of that loop instead of that.
Right.
So there's a lot of flexibility there, but that's based on the school buses.
But it doesn't change. It changes every year, but not every week, right?
No, it changes every year. So the other thing is, and you know, one of the first things I did when I started working as an operations manager was ride around with the guys in the snowplow. Get up at 3, they go out on their road. So I went out with Sid one night. We started and we came by the town office here, and by the time we finished the loop, the side of the road that we had plowed on our way out was full of a foot of snow.
Mm-hmm.
So part of the problem is that when snowstorms happen, it's 5 hours before we can come around again the second time, even though we've moved a foot of snow. There may be another foot of snow on the road, and there's nothing we can do about that.
Right.
That's the reality that people have to understand in a storm. And timing of a storm, okay, so if a storm starts at 1 a.m, everybody thinks we're heroes, because by the time the snowstorm has put its snow down and we've cleared the roads, everything's good and open. But if it starts at 9 o'clock and there's a foot of snow before we get out on the road, we don't look like heroes. And that's part of the issue that we don't have any control over, Mother Nature and the timing. That's one of the things that we can't do anything about.
How?
Unless we come out in the middle of the night, which is not our policy.
So I guess we want to try to wrap this up for tonight here pretty soon, because we have other things on our agenda. So, couple of things. We can go back to the question and answer thing and try to put in some more answers to some of the questions that have been raised over the course of this discussion and in emails and on front porch forum things. When you have a chance in between storms, or maybe Toby can do it for you because you're pretty busy, is to check with Worcester with the idea of shared space. Then we can try to go to some other areas in town and do a similar type meeting, maybe in East Calais, maybe in Adamat, whatever, to get more input, give people a chance to better understand. I think a lot of this is just education, so people understand really what's going on. And trying to come up with some other alternatives, like the Worcester idea.
Seems that it almost gets down to the expense of loaders, another loader, and that's not cheap. And
right.
It would be pretty hard to justify it. And then there's the space to keep a sandwich.
Does anybody know how...
Were you done?
No, I was... thinking not only this part of Calais, but as soon as you mentioned Adamant, I thought, well, geez, they're going to want a loader and a pile of sand down there, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's almost like, if you do it in this one area, then people are going to maybe expect it in another area. So there's a lot of variables, as I think you're realizing in listening to all of this.
Yeah.
So I appreciate everybody's time. Did you have something else you wanted to say?
I have a question. Does anybody know how the state is able to load onto their website where their plow trucks are? How does that work? The state has that.
GPS is in their trucks.
So is there anywhere a conversation about towns being able to kind of add to that?
Oh, so you could look on the website or something see where the truck is?
You can literally watch the trucks on the state roads so that you can time...
I didn't know you could do that.
Yes, you can. You can time your commute to be behind the truck.
Right, and then they'll be trying to pass us because we're going too slow.
I mean, some people maybe...
Not everybody else,
but I think most people...
You see it every day. I see it every day.
People
on the county road passing me to go to a snow-covered road because they're in a hurry, and I'm going much slower than what they want to. And then they do. They zoom right out around me, and they're gone.
Yeah.
So people are going to do that. They're just going to do that.
Yeah. Rose, you had something?
Yeah.
To say?
For example, tomorrow's storm is, I guess maybe it's predicted to not start snowing till maybe 4 p.m. or something. So is the road crew going to start work at 7 a.m. and then the snow starts at 4, and then, or, you know, like, do you have a plan that, okay, we know, you know, so what's the game plan for tomorrow?
If it starts at 4, we're not going to do anything until Monday, or until 3 o'clock the following morning, because that's what our policy is. So if I go out, it's starting snow at 4 o'clock,
Well, four in the afternoon.
It's a durational storm. We're talking 6 inches in 12 hours or 15 hours.
Well, I thought we were supposed to get 6 to 12, right?
Right, but it's all done Wednesday morning. It's all over with. So it's just an overnight type storm. So I can go out and start at 4 o'clock with a half an inch of snow if you want me to. But now I'm working all night because it's 6 hours to do a route. Mm-hmm. So I'm starting at 4. It's 10 o'clock when I get done my first time around. It's still snowing. The sand and stuff that we put down at 4 o'clock, it's all covered up. It's covered up in 15 minutes.
Well,
that's
I've always been...
That's what I was saying about conserving the sand. I'm sorry.
No, I am always in favor of, and I've said this before, of staggering the hours. And my son used to part-time for the town at East Montpelier, and he used to start work at 8 o'clock at night till 2 in the morning. He was there, like, per diem fill-in. And so I think that that's a really important thing that we all should consider, is staggering the routes, staggering the drivers. Not everybody works, you know, 4 in the morning till whatever time you finish, and then, you know, and I know you don't do that because I've seen the timesheets that they're longer, but I'm thinking, so I was at work all day, so last I knew, the storm isn't supposed to start till in the afternoon tomorrow,
right.
But I was thinking, so is everybody coming in at 7 tomorrow when maybe
so
their hours would be better allocated if they were 3 to 11
yes,
tomorrow instead of 7 to 3, you
right,
know.
But
so.
You can't ask guys to work that night shift for regular pay. That's not fair.
Well, we
so
have
you're saying have us not come in at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning, so we got the whole day off to ourselves, but we come in at 7 o'clock
they
at night?
They should be sleeping.
Or at 4 o'clock at night?
4 o'clock in the afternoon. I don't know. I'm just thinking outside of the box. I think that we need to be really different. And these are good solutions. My son now works for AOT. He plows the interstate. And in the last pay period, he worked 188 hours in 2 weeks. So he starts at midnight until 3:30 in the afternoon or whatever. And the state can afford that. But I'm not saying that we need to do that. But I'm just saying, you know, he usually works 7 to 3:30. But when they know it's snowing, he starts at midnight. So, you know, you just have to think about all these different things. You know,
I agree.
You have to stagger
to
shifts. You have to
step back and think out of the box.
Yeah, like when he, like if Alfred is done, then you get the per diem on the truck for another 4 hours, you know. And
well,
I do have
the part-time folks.
Yeah, that's what I mean, the part-time people. Like the four, you know, you swap them. You just, the trucks, I think, need to be moving more. And I do want to say that I did come up Lightning Ridge Wednesday night at 8 o'clock, and it was the scariest trip of my life. And I really, really was scared.
You mean last week, Wednesday?
This past Wednesday when it was just, we had all that rain.
Ice everywhere. Yeah.
And there's such a big crown on it, so you really have to go right up the middle. And I have an all-wheel drive Subaru with 4 studded Hakkapeliitta snow tires, but it was the scariest trip of my life. And I'll just say that I live on Lightning Ridge, right at the top.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think we really need to stagger shifts and just be more creative. And
well, we'll put that down in our list of ideas. Thank you, Rose. And just so folks know, in looking at time that the crew has outside of regular hours, from November 1st to February 3rd, the regular 4 road crew folks have, this is just overtime, this isn't regular hours, 721 hours of overtime. And the 3 part-time folks, in addition to the overtime that the road crew has put in, have worked 237 and a half hours. And that's cost the town $27,219. And that's just so you get the picture of how much time people are spending, you know, in overtime.
Yeah. So, I mean, hiring more people, more part-timers.
Part-timers, remember, when they get hired, they have to have a CDL.
Uh-huh.
Class 2?
Is it just hard to find people?
Class A or B.
Yeah, it's very hard to find. Yeah, it's hard to find anyone with experience.
And availability.
Drop test.
Hey, I need you tomorrow. I need you tomorrow, Mark. Tomorrow night. Oh, sorry. I'm gonna take care of the kid. You know, it's not like you'd have to find people that you could put on a retainer, that they would hold themselves available for your call, in order to make it really work.
And one of our part-time people is no longer available, so now we're down to two part-time people.
Right. I mean, that's one of the issues, that finding per diems is really difficult.
Yeah.
And you just don't want to put just anybody in these trucks. I mean,
intense work. Yeah, I can imagine.
And there's a lot going on there. The trucks are expensive. There's a lot of levers. There's you got cars coming at you. You got a wing hanging off the side of the truck, 5 feet.
Yeah.
There's really a lot there, so you can't just pick somebody off the street to put in these,
right,
these trucks.
Right. No, I appreciate
so
that.
I know the first part of last year, I went without anybody. I had three people, and I just couldn't find another full-time employee.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It was just that hard to find anybody. And this year, luckily, I ended up with, I have two spare guys.
Yeah, we have the jackpot
this year.
Which is
helpful. But again, it's hard to... One of my guys right now, I called him this morning because somebody was out sick. I called him. Nope, I have to. My wife was sick last night. I have to stay and watch the kids today. So to have somebody part-time, it's a commitment. And not everybody wants to just devote all that time
to wait
for Alfie to call.
Right. And
at
that,
whatever
that,
time. That's,
right.
It's
to not
very
know what
hard
their,
position
right.
to fill.
Because they don't know what their paycheck's going to be.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And I can never tell. It's all about Mother Nature. When it happens, when I go to work, somebody calls in sick. I don't know that until I get there. You know what I mean? This guy was trying to get me to, is still trying to get me to tell him what day I need him. But I can't because I can't read the future.
Yeah.
So.
It's, like I said, I think everybody appreciates that this is not, the more you get into it and the more you understand about what's going on, you realize how complicated it is. It seems like it should be like, oh, well, let's just do this, and it's not that easy. And we want good, qualified people,
right.
You know.
And a truck is down? What?
We had one of the trucks, International, the engine blew, wasn't covered, so we had to do a lease purchase for a Western Star. When you order a truck, which they ordered it in November, it's a whole long process just to get the truck. And when you get the truck, you have to send it to this other place, which names I can't remember. But you have to, then they have to put on the body, the plows, all of the extra equipment that the truck needs. So right now we're using what we call the spare truck, which is, you know, why we've just been lucky that hasn't broken down, and we would be down to only three trucks with four people to drive them. So, and I think you said that truck was supposed to be ready.
So the good news is our new truck will be here tomorrow.
Oh, perfect timing.
For this next storm.
Perfect timing.
Just curious. It wasn't worth just replacing the engine.
Oh. No, we had that.
That's a whole other hour discussion.
Another whole hour.
On another day.
Right, or look at the minutes.
You've gone through that one.
Yeah, we did this, for several months.
On this, I will just say to people, if you've got questions about the road, call me. I'd be happy to talk to you and explain to you my side of the story, why we didn't plow the road that day, or why we were late, or whatever. Because there's a lot of things. There's a truck breaking down. I'm down a man. I'm waiting for the rain that's coming after the 3 inches of snow. There's a lot of different things that I can help you understand why the roads aren't in better shape.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm just saying, feel free to call me, because I'm not that hard to talk to.
No,
I'm not always near the phone.
No.
But if you leave me a message, I'll return.
Right. Oh,
so I'm just saying, pass that on to others as well, because I have no problem.
I will, and I know Carolyn Morton spent a lot of time talking to you, and I know she really appreciated talking to you.
Yeah.
But I think we do need to, you know, as we talked about some other options, maybe thinking outside the box.
Thinking about our budget,
thinking
what we
about
spend
the budget
money on as a town, and
right.
that means cutting certain things. I mean, to me, it's like being in the car is the most dangerous thing we all do every day.
Mm-hmm. It is.
And the roads need to be really safe, and, you know, particularly around commute times, but also all the time. You know,
right.
You're driving in the middle of the night, there are other people that are, and
Well, and the other thing to remember is somebody may commute at 7 and somebody else may commute at 9, and there's a 2-hour difference, and that same road at 7 may be perfect and at 9 may be terrible, and you're going to have two different impressions of what the road crew has been up to.
Right.
Because of the timing, and that's
right.
A really important thing for people to understand.
Yeah.
That every time we plow, the next time we come by, it's not going to be any sooner than 5 to 6 hours later on whatever road we plowed. We go by your house at 7 and the storm's still going, you're not going to see us till mid-afternoon or whatever, because that's the next time the guys can finish their route, take a little break, and then go out again, depending on the weather. So it's a real, you know, it's unfortunate, but there's no way we can constantly keep your road open in the middle of a storm. And the timing is going to be Mother Nature and when we start and what our path of our route is.
And I've talked to enough other towns to know that everybody's kind of facing the same problem.
This year.
Especially this year. You know, the way the weather has been, it's just a nightmare. But I've never known Alfred to not, he's always cared about making sure the roads are safe. I've never doubted that either. No.
Not at all.
There's no question in my mind that that's his main concern and his main focus, and I would never doubt that.
With climate change, is that gonna continue? Are years gonna continue to get worse?
Well, I think that's a good question.
Or
I think that's something we really have to think about.
When the polar bears start climbing up your house, yes.
No, I think it's a fair statement to say.
Because it seems like ice is
right.
More of an issue now.
Yeah.
Than it was years
right.
ago.
Yeah. And we may have to think about next year getting in even more sand. You know, in realizing that the last couple of years the weather has been more intense, and maybe we need to increase our sand pile.
The other information that's really important is, so if Alfie drives by and puts a load of sand on an icy road and it's still raining, within an hour the rain is going to wash that sand right off. There's nothing we can do about that. There's no other product that we can put down that will keep that road safe if it continues raining.
And don't forget, sometimes the reason they leave some snow down is because the snow absorbs some of the rain.
And there's better traction in slush than there is on a slick, icy road. So those are all so when you say, oh my God, why didn't they plow the snow off? It's all slushy, it's terrible. There's a reason behind that, for the most part, is that we're trying to keep the road as safe as possible in a very bad storm event.
Yeah.
And we don't have any control over
right,
that. That's Mother Nature.
Right, but it's also just manpower
right.
and money.
Right.
I mean, that's just what I'm hearing.
Yeah.
And so that's mostly where my mind goes to, rather than why aren't these guys doing anything. I just think all the time, we don't have enough manpower. So.
And we don't have enough. And we don't have enough money.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or trucks. We don't.
Right.
Have,
and we don't have enough. We don't have enough
trucks,
equipment.
Materials.
Right.
I mean, it's a very expensive.
I know. To me, it's worth the expense when we're talking about safety.
I don't disagree with you, but others
yeah.
would.
So we have to have a discussion as a town about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think sooner than later.
Well, somebody could bring it up under other business at town meeting. Just to get a sense of where people, you know, what people feel.
So I'll just say that I've been on the road crew for 22 years. And it's always been four guys. For 22 years, we've been only four-man crew.
Yep.
Granted, the equipment has gotten much better since the day that I started.
You think?
It's much better. I'm not going to say it isn't.
Yeah.
It really has. But if I don't have the figures in front of me as far as how many more people are in town now than what used to be 20 years ago. But everybody knows in this room that there's a lot more traffic on these roads now than they were 20 years ago.
Oh, for sure there is. Because I've been here longer.
So with more traffic, there comes more demand.
Right.
If the road crew and the manpower is still the same, and you've got more demand, I agree.
Yeah.
We need more help, more equipment.
So we really need to put this to rest for tonight. I think there's some things that we can check into. And come up with a plan to either meet here again at another select board meeting. I can't promise you it will be next select board meeting, because that's the one right before town meeting and we have to get prepared. But it's not something that we're going to just forget about, just so you know. And we'll let you know when there's going to be another meeting.
Sounds good.
Thank you very
Thanks
much.
Thanks for listening.
Thank you for having a really respectful conversation.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Call me anytime.
Thank you.
And don't forget to take
you can
the
call handouts. Me anytime,
sure. What would you like me to call you?
Stuart.
Stuart, there you go.
All right. So I would like to do, I know we're behind, I figured we would be, while Alfred and Toby are still here, municipal roads general permit. We need to sign off on that and get it into the state by April 1st, right? And we need to get a check, Sandra, to do a check for $1,750.
That's not due till July 1st.
The check?
Right.
Oh, I thought it was all due at the same time.
No.
Okay. So everything is set to go, and this is not something that we have control over. This is the new state law that we have to play by their rules. So would somebody like to authorize me to sign Municipal Roads General Permit application?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, is there any further discussion? Questions? Any questions?
Do you have to do that every year?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
With a check.
Yep. The check's the most important part.
So just so you know, the NRGP really doesn't have any requirements until like 2020 where you actually have to start doing work. We are actually doing a lot of the work ahead of time. We've already done a road erosion inventory that's already in place. So we've done a lot of the pieces of what we'll be required to do way ahead of the curve. The other thing you should be aware of is the state is thinking about updating their standard for bridge and road standards.
Yes.
And what they're trying to do is meld the MRGP erosion issues into the road standard that they have every town have to meet in order to get the state funding.
That makes sense that they would.
Right. So they're so they have a draft document. Alfred and I went through a snowstorm and we're the only two people there. Everybody else called in because they were chicken shits. But we sat down with them and essentially most of what they have in their new quote unquote state road and bridge standard is what we already have in our standards. And I've asked the VTrans people to tell me directly that our standard already meets their new proposal. So I'm waiting to hear on that. So
you mean our separate road standard?
Our town's road standard.
Yeah, road and bridge standard.
Yeah, I saw a little blurb in their document. I read the stuff that you sent around, mm-hmm. and it said that if your standards are more significant, or what, I don't remember what the right word was, but if your standards are more stringent than theirs, then they comply.
Right, so we just, so I just need them to officially say that our standards meet what their new proposal is. Mm-hmm. And it's still a draft, it's not official yet, mm-hmm. so it's, you know, until they roll it out and say this is the new standard, we're still good.
Okay.
So, but
well, good. I'm glad you guys were the heroes and went.
Well, we wanted to make sure they were doing the right thing.
Did you have to go to St. Jay?
No,
it was in Berlin. I was actually thinking about going, but then when the weather hit, I was chicken.
Scared.
That's right. All right, so we have a motion pending. Mm-hmm. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none. Thank you. Be safe during this next storm.
Yeah. Just 6 inches.
I heard 6 to 15. What did you hear?
I heard 6 to 10.
Your prediction is 6.
We can handle whatever we get.
Yeah.
We've got a full head of steam now with trucks, so.
Right. Now who's route?
Paul, you will see that shiny truck by your house. Yeah.
Maybe I'll have to catch a ride.
She won't be awake when he goes to the high school.
No, yeah, yeah, I am, because it's like 8 or 9 o'clock.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'll have Paul stop next time.
Yeah.
Stop for coffee.
Yeah, I'll give him coffee and blueberry muffins.
It's a very nice looking truck.
You should.
Everybody will like it.
Skip that and just tell him you want to go for a ride.
Yeah, no spilling coffee in that new truck.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Exciting. Good night.
Take care.
Thank you, guys.
Have a good evening, guys.
Is it time for?
We need to. We can move the Nemrec thing till after Tom is done. Yeah, I think anything else can wait. Is Craig coming?
He can't make it tonight.
Oh, okay.
He sends his best.
Okay. I didn't hear back from either of you whether you got the agenda, and I thought. When I got here tonight, I thought, oh, I never really heard back from either of you. I hope you got it.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
So, what's new at the library?
Oh, good. Well, first I have to tell you, I really appreciated your discussion on winter roads. I was on the Worcester Selectboard for 5 years, and of course this was a very common topic for us.
Mm-hmm. And it is every town.
Norton Road is over near Route 12, and it has a steep section. Mm-hmm. And 1 year we had hired a new road commissioner, and on the very same day, in the afternoon, I ran into someone who lives on Norton Road, and he said, I've lived on this road for 20 years, it's the first time it's ever been sanded properly. This new road commissioner is great. Like 3 hours later, I'm at home, I get a call from his neighbor 2 houses away about the new road commissioner is wasting all our money. Too much sand on the road.
Right, you can't okay. win. So Worcester, it's complicated. So Worcester doesn't have a winter operations plan then?
Well, I couldn't tell you not what they have now, because it's been
I mean, roads are a huge issue, and they're a huge part of any town's budget.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and yeah, it would be great, I'm sure, to have another person, more equipment, but that's all a huge expense. So, anyways, it happens every year.
Thanks for having me here tonight.
Thanks for coming.
I'm glad to be here. And I'll tell you a few things about what's going on at the library, and then, of course, answer any questions that you have. We're still one of the very busiest libraries in the state of Vermont. We serve 17,000 people from the 6 communities in this area, including Calais. And only Burlington has a busier library, and they serve 42,000 people. So
how many did you say you serve?
We serve 17,000. Yep, in our 6 communities. So it's great. We're on a perpetually tight budget. We watch our money very carefully. We get in the current year we're getting 52% of our income from taxpayers in 6 communities, and we have a endowment. We do not touch the endowment. We live with whatever we can make on the endowment, so that works out very well, and it lasts that way. And we do a lot of fundraising and send out appeals, and we get a lot of support that way, and it's great. We get to do a lot of extra things because of some people who make extra donations. We just, a few months ago, replaced our 14 public computers, and we did that with a donation. Someone had made a donation to the library,
nice.
Specifically for new computers. Over the last 2 years, we've done a lot of necessary landscaping out front, and we were able to do that completely with donations too. So donations beyond the regular ones that we get. We're in the, something you'll be hearing about later this year, we're in the process of raising money for an upgraded elevator. We're not asking any of the communities for any money for that at all.
Does that mean a handicap accessible?
It is. So yeah. Our elevator is 45 years old.
Right, you can get grants for those,
And we asked one of the things I was working on before I came over here.
Right. The only reason I know is because we got one for the town hall.
Oh, yeah, it's good. So we have a grant application that's going in on Friday. Mm-hmm. And so we've been working on that for a while. Mm-hmm. And we have a second grant that we're applying for related to that, too. So we're optimistic.
Good.
So, because as you know, elevators cost a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't actually have to change the elevator cab. We have to change all the mechanism that controls it and all the control system, mm-hmm. and and all of those parts. So it's mostly stuff that people don't see. But anyway, we're looking forward to that. But we're working on that through grants and through private donations, so we're not asking taxpayers for any support on that project. And that's part of a larger scope project with a number of larger, mainly capital types of improvements on the property. And again, we're doing that through grants and private donations and some fundraising will be coming up later, but not taxpayers. So, last year, Calais gave us an increase. All the towns did last year. We went from $16 per capita to $17 per capita. So it was an increase of about $1,300 for Calais. And it was the first time in 6 years that we had actually asked for an increase. So this year we're not asking for any increase, so it's still $27,132 that we're asking for again.
I have that committed to memory too, that amount.
Yeah? Oh, that's good. Wasn't it great? Because when you're working on a budget, you got all these numbers in your head. And then 3 months later, it's like, what was that one? Yeah, I don't know. I find it easy to remember all the numbers while we're working on them. But
right.
Later on,
yeah.
Like, yeah. So, but we have, a lot going on at the library. Again, it's perpetually busy. We do lots and lots of programming.
Yeah, I see
in
that.
The children's library, yeah. And the adult library. In April, we have Poem City coming up, which is, we have a couple dozen programs throughout the month. And let's see, I'm not sure, it's not confirmed yet, but we have at least one program in each of the towns in addition. Most of the programs are centrally located in Montpelier, but we have programs in each of the towns also. So there are a couple of possibilities for Calais. So we'll see what we have. So that's all going well.
Good, yeah. Good, that's great. Are you going to have a handout like you usually do for town meetings?
Yeah. You want some numbers?
It's usually blue.
Oh.
There it is.
Well, I had a choice of blue paper today, Denise, or green, and I went with the blue.
I'm partial to blue.
It's a good thing I did blue.
And did we hear about your retirement from the...
Oh, yeah. I'm retiring on June 30th.
And you're not going to be at the library anymore?
No, I'm not. So this would be 5 years that I've been there.
Well, yeah, when you took over, though, you weren't going to... take over.
Oh, yeah.
It was going to be temporary, remember?
I took it as an interim position while they were doing the search.
Right.
And I said I was not a candidate.
And here you are.
After they did the search. Well, you know, the hard thing to do, right now they're starting the search, and they're really focusing and hoping to get more applicants from Vermont, because one of the things that happened last time is they had over 30 applicants, and quite a few of them from out of state. And what happened was virtually all the out of state applicants, as soon as they found out what the pay scale was, they changed their minds.
Right.
And they weren't interested anymore. So they're really hoping to get people who have an idea of what, Vermont salaries are like. Because it's different.
Yeah, it's different. That's for sure it is.
So we were talking with staff about people who might apply for the job, and they were going through, well, get somebody with this and this and this and this and all these things. And I said, and I hope we do, but that person can make twice as much in Connecticut or Massachusetts, so the odds of them.
We have that problem statewide.
We do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But we get people who
want to be here because they like it.
I was going to say, but the reality, what people find out, though, is the lifestyle and all that is just so much better. People move here for that reason, so you got people kind of crossing.
So one side has numbers, and the other side has narrative. And this is the report that I sent for your annual report.
Right.
Oh,
okay. Perfect.
So, but there are a bunch of numbers and information there.
Mm-hmm.
And the front side, the top is general things about the library overall, and the bottom section is information specific to Calais. I have plenty more of them if anybody needs them.
Do you usually leave some of the...
I can leave all of them. I can leave all of these for you. Sure.
Yeah, I'll leave them for
And I'll give Craig more, too, so if any...
Okay, you know, I'll leave them for the office staff to use as a handout.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have, last year we lent over 16,000 items electronically, and the e-books are really popular with some people. Not as popular as you might think, though, because, I mean, some people like take them on vacation and stuff, because then they can just take one small item on the internet to carry three books if they got
right.
three books in a week. So, but regular old books are by far the most popular thing we have. So,
I'm glad to hear that, actually.
So,
So that has changed. Books would go away.
Yeah. So the e-books are another possibility. One of the things that we did a few years ago, two things that I did for Calais when I started, but two things that were helpful to Calais and to Worcester. We used to have a four-day borrowing period for like DVDs.
Mm-hmm.
We still carry DVDs and CDs. We have people in all six of our communities, including the city of Montpelier, who have terrible internet. And so they can't rent movies over the internet from Netflix or something because
right.
they can't stream them. So so those people still appreciate that we carry DVDs,
mm-hmm.
and those are still popular items. But one of the other things we did is it used to be a four-day lending period for DVDs.
That's pretty short.
It's short. It's short, especially if you live in Calais or Worcester. And the first year I was at the library, I got a number of complaints from people that, you know, I come in town once a week, so it just doesn't work for me. So we increased it to 7 days. So it's a
or
full
you have a snowstorm.
Week for those items.
Oh,
yeah, or you have a snowstorm.
Right.
And we provide it. We give people exceptions for snowstorm,
well,
flooding and stuff like that. And but
great. I get my mail at Adamant Co-op, and I love that there's that little.
Book.
You do too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that little book
yeah.
exchange.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really great.
It's on the honor system.
And it's to, yeah, right?
Yeah.
It's I cannot read a book in 2 or 3 weeks, you know, my 1 or 2 pages a night before I fall asleep.
Yeah.
Right. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Oh, good.
And you're it's
welcome.
Working, right? Even though it's honor system.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
aren't
it's
you doing
honor
it,
system, we...
Aren't you doing it at Maple Corner, or is that a separate... Maybe
does
the Maple Corner store has books, right?
It does, but that's
separate.
They're free books there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but the Adamant, it's an honor system. It works really well. We occasionally lose a book, but not too often.
Yeah, well, that's good though.
So
honor system still works.
Yeah, it does.
I'm
so
happy.
We replace the books every 3 weeks, or yeah, we have, you know,
well,
a bunch.
Yeah.
We take requests. So
nice.
So.
Great. Well, I mean,
so valuable. So valuable.
You've really done a lot with public relations and communication since you came on, so I just want to
yeah.
let you know how much we appreciate that and
thank you.
How valuable that is, and we're going to miss you.
Oh, thank you. It's a great place to work, and one of the things, people just love the library, so they're, you know, it's just
isn't that great,
constantly
though?
Get all these positive things
yeah.
that people have to say
yeah.
about it.
Yeah, I don't think libraries are going away anytime soon, at least not in Vermont.
We still have more libraries per capita than any other state.
Do we really?
Yeah.
That's good.
Of course, the majority of them are really tiny libraries. They're like the size of this room,
mm-hmm.
not even including that part. A lot of them are that size.
Right, right.
We have a couple of libraries in the state that don't have plumbing or electricity, but, you know, but they...
Yeah.
That's not typical, but that's it.
Right.
At an extreme.
Now, might you be a member of the board after this?
I won't be.
No.
I think that would be very weird for some of the staff, especially for the administration.
Yeah, well, unless you waited
difficult.
Some time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Well, thank you so much.
Oh, you're
thanks,
welcome.
Tom.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, so perhaps we could circle back to the agenda. And we did that. NEMRIC put forth a proposal, and I think Katie put it in the folder. Drive safe.
Good night. Thanks for moving me up on the agenda. I appreciate that.
Sure. Oh, yeah, no
good
problem.
Thanks.
NEMRIC put forth a proposal to be the town's auditor. The person that I had contacted who said yes, they were interested, and then changed their mind and said, oh gee, sorry, I'm not. And I've run out of ideas of who we might get.
Mm-hmm.
NEMRIC's proposal is right there. And they can do it within the amount that we budgeted, which is $6,000. The one question I had when I first looked at this, and I don't have an answer yet, so we don't have to decide tonight if you don't want to, mm-hmm. is it says complete a report of findings and work to the treasurer and select board. My question was, how often? Is that quarterly, mm-hmm. annually? What? How often? So I'd like to have an answer to that question before mm-hmm. I would want to consider their proposal. And they would be doing their work remotely, so chances are that it would be very limited exposure as far as additional costs because of mileage.
The travel time, yeah. So my only thought about this was, you know, this seems like a very good idea and very professional, but is it in any way going to help save us some money on the professional audit, like with Sullivan and Powers? I mean, just seems like we have to spend so much money just to look at the books, you know?
Well, and I think that's just the way things are now, with the changing of times and stuff, and that's why, you know, now we're caught up with the audit from Sullivan and Powers. We've got a contract, we've got the $19,000 budgeted, and we have to have an auditor. Mm-hmm. You know, by state statute, by our charter, we have to have mm-hmm. somebody. And I was hoping to find somebody that would do it for less than the six,
yeah.
but it's just nobody wants to do it.
Yeah.
I don't know if it saves us money on the Sullivan and Powers because, like you say, it's under contract. But I think this solution will save a lot of stress on Sandra.
Yep.
And we realize some savings and benefits from that.
Good. Well, and because we, you know, she really wants somebody to do the auditor. She doesn't like the fact that we don't have somebody doing that right now because it makes her uncomfortable.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's good.
Yeah.
You know?
And I think because it's NMRIC, we potentially get some more powerful reporting here.
Yeah.
And with you, I would want to know what's the frequency.
Right.
I would think it would be monthly if they're doing this monthly.
Well, and that's the question, and I don't think Sandra's gotten an answer yet. Yeah. So.
And I didn't mean to cut you off for sure. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. I think, every time we talk about this, I think that the word, the title of auditor on this work is a little bit of a misnomer because it really is so functionally different than what the outside firm does.
Right. It does get confusing, but that is what the title is.
Sure, it is what the title is, but it lends itself to that thinking, oh, well.
Why do we have two?
Yeah.
And they're just different. This is like a second set of eyes.
Right.
Doing a little bit of work.
Right. This is at like the town level, and Sullivan and Powers is like, you know,
it's a professional
professional auditor.
It's actually an
audit firm. Right.
Yeah. By firm, we use the term internal versus external auditors.
Yeah.
This is like the internal auditor level.
And they're the, and Sullivan and Powers is the
external.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It does get confusing.
Yeah, I think we were working on something, and I changed it to staff auditor or something.
Right. Yeah, that's
not the title.
Right.
But yeah, it's just going to keep
and so,
confusing.
So there's no conflict because you remember how like we used to have Father Gill, and then we had somebody who was going to be the auditor from their firm. So there's not any conflict because we have NMRIC and. And then this person also works for NMRIC. There's not going to be any.
No, because that's different.
Like that.
Because Father Gill was doing the
audit.
The external audit.
Right.
So that was why.
Right. So even though
you remember
she works for NMRIC, we should be okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yep. Makes sense?
Wonderful.
Do you want to wait until we get an answer to that question before we?
I would just tell them that we agree, and we rather than wait for them to answer the question, I would tell them what the answer is.
Yeah.
Or whatever it is.
Yeah. Monthly?
Yeah.
Complete a monthly report.
Yeah, just send them a letter to sign, put the word monthly into our letter.
Well, I think I can just write.
Because what else are we going to do?
I think I can just take it and insert.
Yeah.
This here, and there doesn't seem to be any place to sign it, but if you want, I could sign
Well, you would think that they would have a contract or something.
Right. But apparently it's...
Or it's a proposal.
This is a proposal, so maybe... Yeah, that would make sense, that it's a proposal, so they would come back and we would say, you know, is this monthly? And they may say, no, we mean, you know, we meant quarterly. Mm-hmm. And then if that's the case, then how do you feel about that? You want to rehash it? I mean, I don't know what monthly is going to really do. To me, it seems like quarterly would be reasonable.
Well, unless they just say February 2019, complete, no adverse findings, and a signature.
Yeah, I don't know what
that's
they do.
Their report.
Yeah, I don't know what they do.
Yeah.
Maybe when you guys were doing auditing, what did you... You didn't do like a monthly report or...
No, we approached it like... I mean, the VLCT guidelines for the audit are like this thick. Mm-hmm. It's not that. It's...
Well, Jim's right. Jim.
A lot. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you see... Can you come here?
Yeah, just a second.
Good thing you're here early.
Didn't you not have a job description?
We did have a job description,
but I think that the duties of the auditor are by statute, right?
Well, we
and
we
this
are.
Is what they're proposing that they would do.
On the report and how often we get it. It has to be reasonable. It has to be reasonable for the work and our oversight of it, and it has to be within the price. Otherwise, that's just a kind of a silly proposal, if you know what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
Like if they're saying, hey, we'll do all that, we're rolling a report to you once a year, that doesn't really, that's like what, and we're going to pay you an extra
$6,000.
You know, we're going to pay you more to get the reporting that is reasonable for the work.
I think,
so it has to all fit together for the price.
I think monthly would be great. I could understand it if they said quarterly, because, you know, how much are they really going to do?
We could ask them for, we also should ask them for a template of what the report would look like, to Rose's point, of what are we going to get as a report.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What's the, give, show us a template, show us what we're getting.
Well, I think we need some more answers then before we approve this.
Yeah.
Jim?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What would you like me to, I think we did have a job description.
Yeah, I'd have to go back and see if I can find it, but...
Annually perform an audit of town accounts utilizing the processes described in the most current edition of the Vermont League of Cities and Towns Handbook for Locally Elected Auditors. Present the findings of the annual audit to the voters in the annual town report. Work with the town treasurer and select board to develop and implement a system of internal controls appropriate to the financial activities of the town.
That's not bad.
Including segregation of duties, monthly bank statement reconciliation, and regular deposit of funds. Respond to inquiries and requests for information to public town officials and employees, and perform other duties as assigned.
Okay, so we got some more work to do with this.
Yeah, right, and against that list and against the league's materials.
And we do want the internal controls.
Which is best.
I don't see that as part of...
This is second set of eyes. This is kind of, you know, touching it, looking at it quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Things, it's kind of a sniff test.
Yeah.
It's not that... It's not the VLCT. And then what's the tolerance in between is probably a question that will emerge.
So remember what the point of the exercise was, that every town is required to elect a board of auditors, and they are supposed to perform an annual audit of the town,
right?
The town books. And this is not a professional CPA outside audit, but this is something else that towns are supposed to be doing every year. And the difficulty was that I think we went a period of time, significant period of time, where there was no one elected.
Right.
And so therefore all of those responsibilities that are described in the VLCT handbook were not being performed.
No. That's why we went to the charter.
So that's the goal of the charter, was to be able to appoint, rather than a board of three auditors, a single person who would do those functions.
Mm-hmm.
Because we still have these statutory functions that we're supposed to be performing.
Mm-hmm.
So it was the notion of, we would, rather than elect three, we would appoint one, and they would effectively do, that one person would do over the course of the year, the things that the three would have otherwise done. Part of it was touching, you know, just having the sort of regular contact, a look,
right,
because reconcile, double check.
Because the Sullivan and Powers thing is a once a year.
Or even, I think the charter provides is not less than every 3 years. So this was intended to be an in-between
mm-hmm.
of the regular outside audit.
Right.
So, yeah.
I don't think that list meets, it doesn't say anything about internal controls.
No, and the internal controls was part of a response to the audit report that said that there were some deficiencies in internal controls. So, you know, the system of internal controls was to sort of help segregate the duties and make sure
right.
that those things
and
were
I think
being
we, I think
performed.
Given the setup that we have now, if we had this auditor, we would be meeting the internal controls.
I think
with
so,
what
yeah.
I'm doing and with what
yeah.
Barbara might be doing.
Yeah.
If the budget passes for FY20, I think we will be meeting those internal controls.
Yeah. One of the perhaps what you might think about, I mean, the next step down the road is just eliminating the auditor.
Can we do that?
Replace, yeah, we could amend the charter to just eliminate that function.
And then nobody does it?
And then you go to an annual outside audit.
Right, which is what we're doing right now.
You're doing it annually anyway?
Right.
So I was going to ask you, Jim, under the charter, if we're doing it annually anyway...
What do you need to do this?
Do we even need to do this?
Well, you do, because you have a charter that says you
right.
have to
do
right,
so until we amend the charter, we should be still
yeah.
having somebody. So
yeah.
this might be a short term?
This might be a short term,
mm-hmm.
okay, until we amend the charter to eliminate the Office of Town Auditor.
Which we could do next town meeting.
And at the same time, we amend the town charter to go from not less than every 3 years.
To every year.
To every year. Okay.
Okay. Well, that, I mean, I actually feel better that we're having it annually, even though we don't have to. We don't have an auditor, which we need to. But.
I think this might be, yes, this might be a bridge.
Yeah.
To. The next step.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
It's nice that you showed up when you did.
I try.
All right, so I'm going to say that we're not ready to do anything with this yet. We have some more work to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
Scott Bassage would like to serve on that subcommittee of the town hall to look at the venue. How the building's going to be used, what venues, that kind of thing. So, would we like to appoint Scott to that committee?
I make a motion to appoint Scott Bassage to the subcommittee
yeah.
of the town hall that's working on formulating guidelines for usage.
Thank you.
Is that the name of it?
Yep, sounds good. I'll second that.
Do we have a sense of, we had a good discussion a meeting or two ago,
mm-hmm.
I think so just last meeting, with the two, Nancy and Artie, who were
mm-hmm.
here. Do you have a sense of, if Scott were here, I'd ask him, so tell us, you know, like, what's your interest in the, does he have an angle?
The subcommittee is basically... feels like right now, because nothing is formalized, but it feels like it's going to have two purposes. There'll be one element of it is that actually, okay, we've got this agreement as to what is the use of the town hall. Somebody's got to manage that. That'll be one of the functions that this subcommittee performs. The other function this subcommittee performs will be fundraising. And Scott is interested in being part of the fundraising team.
Okay.
So, I think he's interested in, he would do both.
He would do both, but
right.
yeah. He,
I mean, we really haven't met as a subcommittee only just
right.
once.
Right.
Okay.
But
that's actually good to hear because...
Yeah.
It was while we were discussing this fundraising element of it that Scott said, I would definitely want to be a
right.
part of this.
Right.
Oh, good.
Awesome.
And David Sheets would also.
Yeah, well, he's on there. And we also, I remember the motion, and I didn't see it in the minutes, but Chris Colt was one of the folks that we had put in the motion, but I don't...
Does his name not?
I didn't see it in the minutes, but that's a whole different thing.
Okay.
All right, so there's a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none. Greeter grant. We did the greeter grant at Curtis Pond last year. And Colleen was going to try to make it, but the vet's office stays open late tonight, so she's probably still there. And they would like to do it again. And I think there was a little bit of some bookkeeping hassles, but I think those got resolved. And I think going forward, people are going to be more, understand what their role is better in relation to this. And this is an in-kind grant. So any work that's done by, like, Colleen or Sandra or whatever goes towards the town's share of the grant. And the grant is for $6,379. The match that the town has to match is $1,610. And that is the in-kind. So it doesn't really cost the town anything other than we budgeted last year $250 for the grant.
Mm-hmm.
Where did it go? Sandra sent me a paper. And she ended up spending the town spent $252 on just some out-of-pocket kind of expenses.
Mm-hmm.
What was this for? It had to do with payroll and
miscellaneous supplies,
things.
Mm-hmm.
A chair, things like this.
Yeah. Yeah, and
sunscreen.
Employer taxes, that kind of stuff. The town would have to spend $250 toward it. There's $51.09 in the grant that's left from the town's share of the $250. So, and I think it was well received, and they would like to do it again at Curtis Pond because Curtis Pond, because I asked about rotating it to one of the other ponds,
mm-hmm.
and the feedback that I got was that Curtis Pond is actually the pond that's in the worst shape of any of the ponds in Calais. It's the shallowest. Number 10, Nelson, what are the other ones? But anyways, it is the one that is most susceptible to the invasive species.
Mm-hmm.
So Josh, who is the state guy that came here last year, remember,
mm-hmm.
recommended that we still do it at Curtis. So I just need authority to sign off on this because it's due Friday.
So.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion, questions? All right, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none. Motion carries. All right. Now what do we have? We already talked about... Okay. Cliff, do you want to do a quick... update on an RFP for IT support services?
Sure. We are going to move forward with RFP for IT support services. I have been educating myself as to what other towns here in Vermont have done. I've also looked at it nationally, what some other municipalities throughout the country have done for RFPs. Now what I want to do is circle that back around to the proposals that we received from a few of the companies in the area that are offering that. And try to come up, some of these documents, as you can imagine, they probably had a team of people, working on each individual section of it, and you've got a document that's 48 pages long. And then you've got other ones where it's just a single page. I see ours being somewhere in between there, maybe 6 pages at the most, but that's if we decide to, you know, decorate it with some, well, here's the history of Calais and how we came to be and why we need these IT services. But really what we want to boil it down to is, what are we going to have them take care of for us, and what other types of IT support do we imagine that we will need? And I think the examples that I have give me plenty of input to be able to put together a draft to present to the board that we can then discuss. And if we need to add more meat to it, we can certainly do that. If we want to, you know, tone it down a little, we'll be able to do that. I came up with, my first draft was actually much more aggressive, but I backed that off. So a rough time frame for imagining how this will roll. I would like to be able to put the first copy of the draft RFP in front of the select board at our next meeting. I don't think we'll have enough time to decide and finalize it there because we'll be getting ready for town meetings, mm-hmm. but that could start the discussion. Then after town meeting, we come back and look to finalize that RFP, approve it so that we can then go ahead and publish it by the middle of March and give it a good month to be out there in the world. Let people respond, get the bids back in time, the proposals back in time, so that we can look at it at the select board meeting on April 22nd. At that point, if we see something we really like, we can opt to award it, or we may decide, well, you know, there's a couple of good ones here, let's hear it in person, and then that would give us an option to have another meeting potentially on the 29th, or if we're comfortable with just rolling it into a regular select board meeting, mm-hmm. we could opt to do it that way. And then what I would imagine is by first week in May is when we really should be awarding this thing, because there will be lead time for whoever we award before they can put us on their schedule.
Right.
I'm sure they're going to get busier with all the stuff that's been going on about the flaws in NIMRIC that were discovered.
And also our contract with RB Tech.
Our contract with RB Tech will be coming to a close right around that same time frame. They're wanting to meet with us around May 1st to just go over what they've been doing, and so it kind of all rolls into that time frame as well. And puts us on track so that when we hit the start of the fiscal year, we're moving forward in accordance with that.
Right. Are we going to try to put anything, I mean, I don't know if it's even the right place for it, but are we going to try to put anything in the proposal about the cybersecurity stuff? Is that part of that?
There are elements of that. You will never get anybody to sign off and say, yeah, we'll take full responsibility for that.
Right. But, I mean, given all the recent stuff that's come out about NEMRIC and finding out about it,
I just like to point out too, just I hate to interrupt. The all of the things that have been discovered about NEMRIC, I think we need to be a little careful about that, because NEMRIC, I think that the problems of NEMRIC have always been known to exist. Okay, I don't think that there's anything about NEMRIC that's suddenly become revealed to be not what people who knew about it understood. I think it was presented in, it was presented in such a way that, oh, there's this incredible discovery about the infirmity of NEMRIC. No, I think it's always been, people understood that NEMRIC has its own limitations and is what it is, and that people who have recently come to learn this have discovered it.
Okay?
Yeah. Yeah. It's not, NEMRIC is very old technology.
Yeah,
it's based on what is it? On what?
Fox Pro,
I think. And
yeah.
Fox Pro isn't supported by Microsoft anymore. And
right.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. But it's also, it for better or for worse, you know, it's legacy technology that's been adopted by the state of Vermont, and it is the system of the entire state.
I know, it is. And we just barely got everything converted
and we get
to
off, right. But it is what, you know, it is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the expectation of NEMRIC and everyone else is that the security that would go along with this is built outside of NEMRIC. not mm-hmm. within memory.
So that's not an expectation right? that we should have. So that's an expectation we should have with this RFP then. Because
right,
that
they're going to provide us with that wall.
Right, the yes. cybersecurity.
Yes, yeah. Because I think that folks that have used, been involved with NEMRIC right along have realized it doesn't have any wall itself. It is
yeah.
just, it is you know, Microsoft Word or Excel. Mm-hmm. It is a program that runs, but not.
Yeah, I wish somebody would put something
secure.
Out there, whether it's the state or whatever, explaining that. You know, instead of people thinking as I did.
Oh yeah, the NEMRIC's full of holes and
right,
and
it's like here we are, we just converted, and are we going to be in trouble if something gets breached? You know,
well,
is the town responsible?
You,
and
you need like an Amazon. You know, other customers also bought.
Yeah, right. Yes.
A security
yeah.
blanket, yes. a shell suitcase.
Right.
Yeah. or a firewall. You
yeah.
know, I mean, that's.
Yeah.
yeah.
Good one, Jared.
No,
okay.
seriously. Then I go look to say why.
Right.
And I realize,
yeah.
oh, because I need that too.
Because
yeah.
I need that. Yeah. That's a good point.
But I wish, the state would, because they must be some, I know it's a state approved product. It seems like the state should be stepping in and saying, something doing some kind of a maybe they are maybe they're working on it I don't know because
yeah.
people are going to
maybe not that's what I'm seeing
no, maybe not.
Well, because people are going to a lot of people I'm not probably the only one
yeah
who thought that there was something more that they should be doing.
I think
I think there is something more that you should be doing, but I think that it's something that you should be doing externally
no, I mean,
of NEMRIC and not expecting that there's going to be something within NEMRIC.
That's well, that's what I was
problem.
Thinking, that
yeah.
some NEMRIC should be doing something,
yeah.
because I don't know any better.
Well, but we have the opportunity. The timing is great,
right.
because
right.
we're
yeah.
writing our RFP right now, and Cliff
okay.
understands this all this stuff, and it seems like the vendors are going to understand the issues better than we do.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I hope
so. So if we are able
to
articulate the expectations and in an RFP format, it I think it moves the needle in terms of what they're willing to bring to the table and be clear about in terms of their security tools and the extent to which we can rely on them.
Right, and it puts us in a position to consider these proposals apples to apples because we've defined the outline.
Yeah.
And it also means, Jim, that I would imagine you're going to be seeing this sometime between the 25th and the 11th. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Katie, I did put a copy of this in both folders, so you can find them in there.
And should they get moved from folder to folder for meetings?
Oh, well, yeah, when I do this draft, I'll put it in the folder.
For
and
the
then,
next time.
Exactly.
Okay. All right, great. Okay, I think that's it.
Before we shift, I have one quick thing I want to ask about in the context of the town meeting thing. It doesn't have to be now, but I don't. Before you drop the gavel.
Before we go into executive session?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, now would be the time.
Now's the time, okay. So, one of the things that's in the detailed document that I attached to the email that everybody has is. So this is context as I went to the VLCT training for moderators that they invite Select Board and other people to go to. I was the only one there from Calais.
I've been to it.
No, I'm sure others have been to it. I never had, so I went. But one, there were a lot of things that kind of bubble up. But one of the things that was a point of kind of extended discussion last week was that other business cannot be binding. And so that was like a distinction that I maybe hadn't been clear about, but I guess everybody else is
yeah.
clear. Okay, so things can come up for other business.
Right,
and they're
but we can't make any decisions.
They're all just very interesting.
Right, it wasn't
yeah.
warned. It wasn't a warned item on the warning,
okay.
so.
Okay, yep.
Yep. No, I'm glad you went, because I've been a couple times. It's helpful.
It's really, it's,
yep.
It's, yeah. I wish.
I went once.
Yeah, that was good.
All right. Anything else before we make a motion to go into executive session? Okay.
I make a motion that we go into executive session.